Good morning. Welcome to Ammanford Evangelical Church's online Sunday service. It's really good to have you with us. I wanted to start by reading some verses that we often read at this time that celebrate God becoming man, becoming one of us, walking onto the field of human history. I'm going to read from John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, through this word, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not overcome it. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. It's our prayer, and we'll pray in a moment that we would see his glory as well today. That Sammy speaks to us and tells us the story of how Jesus came to be born through Mary. We're going to look at her story today. It's our prayer that God would shine his light into our lives, shine his light again into our world, that we might see him and know grace and truth. So come on, let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this story about you, about the Word who was there at the beginning, who made the world, who makes and keeps on making us moment by moment. Lord, that you would become flesh, that you would be born of Mary, and born into our world, walk onto the field of human history to rescue us, to bring light into our darkness. Lord, we thank you for that. It's something that is just beyond our understanding. But we pray today that you would help us to understand it just a little bit more, that it would blow our minds again, that you would light up our lives, that you would bring your grace and truth into our own hearts, into our minds, that we might pour it out to others in generosity, as you've been so generous to us. Lord, we thank you for sending your Son. We thank you for giving us your Spirit to see him. Lord Jesus, we ask that you would be lifted up before our eyes and in our hearts today, that we might see you and know the light of life. Amen.
In royal David's city stood a lowly cattle shed, where a mother laid her baby in a manger for his bed. Mary was the mother mild, Jesus Christ, a little child. Down to earth from heaven, who is God and Lord of all, and his shelter was a stable, and his cradle was a stall. With the poor and mean and lowly lived on earth, our Savior. Our childhood's pattern, day by day, like us he grew. He was little, weak and helpless, tears and smiles like us he knew. And he feeleth for our sadness, and he shareth in our gladness. Our eyes at last shall see him through his own redeeming love. For that child so dear and gentle is our Lord in heaven above, and he leads his children on
Well, we're back in Luke's Gospel and we're thinking about the people around experiencing that first nativity. Not the shepherds on the hill, not the wise men from afar, but some of the women who were involved with the birth of Christ. A couple of weeks ago, John brought to us the story of Elizabeth and how that story was filled with joy. How God is a God who shines light into dark places. And today we're going to encounter Mary, who is familiar to most of us, and try to think a little bit about how favour works out. I don't know what you think of when you hear the word favour. Perhaps it's doing a job for someone else, but to find favour, to be favoured, to be a favourite of someone. What is it that jumps into your mind when you hear that word? We're going to be looking at Luke chapter 1, and we're going to begin in verse 26. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and the angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favoured. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favour with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, and he will be great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who has said to be barren is in her sixth month already, for nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." And then the angel left her. Now, at that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favoured that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed is she who has believed what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." And so Mary sang, "My soul glorifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Saviour, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but he has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things. He has sent the rich away empty, but he has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he said, even as he promised to our fathers." Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. I'm going to teach you a new word this morning. Maybe it's not a new word to you, but the word is contronym. Contronym is a feature of the English language, which means we can use the same word to basically describe two very opposite things. We know that synonyms are words that they mean the same thing, but they're different words. Antonyms are two words that mean the opposite. A contronym is something which is one word, but it can be used in two very different opposite ways. An example of that would be to dust. When you dust something, you might sprinkle. This time of year, making cakes for Christmas, you might dust them with icing sugar to cover in the fine stuff. But most of us would use the word dust to mean removing of that. After making the cakes, we might have to dust to clear up. It's a contronym. It's a word which is the opposite of itself depending on how and when it's used. And I think favour in this passage shows us that it can be a contronym. When you think about the favour spoken about in Luke chapter 1, what springs to mind? When the angel approaches Mary, who describes herself as one who is to be known and admired, called blessed from generation to generation. And the angel approaches her and twice informs her that she is favoured, that she has found favour in the eyes of God. What does that evoke in you? For me, my instinct was to think of it sort of in terms of a favourite teacher in school. That there's a teacher that has found my favour. That there's something about them. Their style, their subject, the environment they created that made them to be my favourite. Or, looking at it the other way, I suppose, probably makes more sense. When a student is a teacher's favourite student, their favourite, they're favoured, they find favour in the eyes of that teacher. It's probably because they show an aptitude to the subject that they're teaching, or because they behave very well in their class and their general demeanour is pleasant, what have you, in the face of so many little ones who are rude and obnoxious and horrible. We have that idea, don't we? That to find someone's favour, to be their favourite, should really have an explanation. Oh, this is my favourite TV show because it makes me laugh more than any other. It's got my favourite characters in, the ones that I relate to the most. We often think that there's a reason behind that link that is formed by being favoured. But that is the exact opposite of what's being meant in Luke chapter 1. You see, when the angel comes to Mary and announces this favour that she has found, that she is favoured in the eyes of God, that she is to be privileged with this honour, this great glorious duty of bearing the Saviour in her body, giving birth to the Christ the Messiah. That favour is not based on anything that she has done. There is no explanation that she is the purest of all of the young girls in Judea at the time. There is no explanation there that she had visited the temple more, or memorized more Torah, or given more money to have sacrifices done in her name, or anything like that. It's simply this, that she has found favor. Now, if you've got a smartphone or a computer, you can look up the Greek behind this, just so that you know that I'm not making this up. It's actually the word, the verb form to find favour of grace. A little bit later on, Elizabeth fleshes out how this word is being used when she can't believe that Mary, the mother of her Lord and Saviour, has visited her. This is what she said. Why am I so favoured? Why would you bring yourself and him to me? Can you see that there's this sense in which she can't understand, she can't explain, it's for no reason in particular, it's simply the kindness of God that is motivated and moved this. We usually have this description, don't we? That grace is given to someone who doesn't deserve it. It's God's kindness to those who don't deserve it. So when we read this story, perhaps when we fill our minds with images of a holy and pure and blameless Mother Mary of Jesus, we might be led down the path that God's kindness is shown in particular to those who have earned it, to those who are diligent and faithful and holy and pure and righteous and whatever other sort of words we might choose. But this is a story that is first and foremost showing us that God's kindness shows up in situations where we really shouldn't expect it. Where there's no explanation, There's no description that can be given why that kindness is being shown. So, far from favour being anything to do with reason, the nativity is wrapped up in God showing kindness that isn't deserved. On Sunday morning, we've got our nativity in Llandybia, and I'm going to be giving a very similar talk to this to the kids, and I'm going to take these chocolates there with me, and I'm going to ask them who they think deserves this chocolate. Will I give it to my favourite ones? Who will find favour and why should I give it to them? And I'm going to let you in on a little secret. I'm not going to give it to the ones who listen the best. I'm not going to give it to the ones who call me pastor when they pass me in the street. I'm going to give them out freely to those who are listening and to those who are not. Because it's an illustration of God's favour and God's grace. Totally undeserved. Totally and utterly unearned. And I wonder about you. Are you still hoping that God will treat you kindly because you've done a long list of the right things? I hope you're not. Because God's kindness doesn't work like that. In fact, if it was down to you and your good deeds and your righteousness and your holiness, there'd be a solid case that could be made about why God shouldn't show you kindness. So this morning, as we think about this favour, about this grace, about this kindness given, it is really good news for all of us that we might receive the chocolate, not because we've been listening carefully. Mary might earn this privilege, not because she's particularly holy and blameless, but because God is a God who shows kindness when it isn't expected. But it teaches us something more about favour and kindness as well. And I want us just to wonder about how tangible the goodness and the graciousness of God to us is. If you read what Gabriel announces to Mary, he tells her that she's going to have a child. And the things that he starts to list about that child are quite amazing. Like there would be this universal acceptance and agreement that this is something good. Mary says, you're going to have a baby, you will call him Jesus, which literally means God saves. And he is going to be this great saviour whose throne lasts and kingdom does not end. It's great news, isn't it? It is good news. It is kindness being shown. But I wonder, like, how much we can take on board those out there in the ether, great acts of history sort of kindness. And whether that's where we think the kindness of God ends, in our ideas, in our theology, in our descriptions and our hopes for the future. Because this is very much a story which speaks to us about how personal, how near, how tangible the favour and the grace of God is. Again, these bags of chocolate. You know, I'll be able to ask the kids on Sunday morning. It's good news that I've got chocolates, isn't it? It's good news that I've got enough to give to everyone. And in a sense, yes, that will be good news. But really, for that good news to be experienced, it needs to be touched and unwrapped and devoured and ingested. It's good news that I will be giving these out on Sunday morning. And the children will be able to take them and eat them and enjoy them. It's good news for everyone if they get to eat it. Or if they're a dog, never give chocolate to dogs. But that's a bit like what we have in this story here. That the good news of God the rescuer coming isn't just something that's out there. It's something that's deeply personal to Mary. And we see the exact same thing expressed by Elizabeth. She sees the grace of God in having this visit of Mary, not simply being the vessel of the Saviour of the world, but having approached her, of having come to her, of having brought the Saviour near and into her home. Surely for good news to be good news, it needs to arrive at our door. It needs to come and be in front of us. the favour that Mary is shown is a linking up of that big out there idea sort of good news that Jesus, the Saviour, was coming, but it was deeply, deeply personal. Mary, says the angel Gabriel, you are favoured. Elizabeth, who am I that I should be favoured? When Mary sings, she says this, my soul glorifies the Lord, my spirit rejoices in my God, my Saviour, for he has been mindful of me. To me, a humble servant, he has come near. Because of what he has done, my name will be revered from generation to generation. So I want us again this morning, not just to think, what do we understand by favour? Is it something that we earn? Is it something that we tease out of God? Is it something that we can work and fight and grapple towards? Of course not. It's unmerited, it's undeserved, it's kindness shown on purpose to those who don't deserve it. But it's more than simply an idea. The good news of Christ coming into our world is good news to each and every one of us. Is the good news to you? Not in a debate-style format, salvation by faith, anti-salvation by faith. Which one will you sort of, I've listened to the arguments and I think it's this one. But is it for you that Christ has come into the world to lift you up out of the darkness, to lift you up out of sin and shame and guilt, to rescue you from death and deliver you into his life? Is it good news for you? What about the promises that God makes in Jesus, not just for the things that he has done, but for the things that he will do? Something we've been trying to major on this Advent season already, isn't it? That Christ, who has come, will return to make all things new again. It's great news that this world, which is still broken, this world which is still falling apart at the seams, this world that is still filled with sorrow and sadness and suffering, will be made new once more. But is it your good news? In Jesus, are you anticipating taking part in that? Christ's promises for those of us who looked at him through eyes of faith, put our lives in his hands, will one day get to enjoy that with him forever. Favour is deeply personal. So don't let it remain simply in the realm of ideas, but something which has arrived, taken root in your own life through faith in Jesus. Now there's one quick question I want to finish with. And that is, what does favour end up doing then? If that's what favour is, undeserved kindness, if favour is really supposed to be up close and personal, like in your face and in your life, what does it do? Now, because I'm a little bit worried. I've got a very low view of Ammanford kids, as it happens, and I'm worried that if I do not distribute these coins, these chocolate coins, evenly on Sunday morning, what will end up happening is that some kids will rub their favour in the noses of those who haven't received the favour. Does that make sense? That being shown kindness, especially when it isn't deserved, can often puff us up. It can make us smug. I just have the scene in my mind already that one kid is going to turn to another and go, no, I've got more chocolate than you do. But that's not what favour should produce. That's not what the favour of God produces in those who find it, who receive it. Favour, when we understand it as Mary and as Elizabeth did, that receiving of undeserved kindness into their lives should make us exceptionally grateful people. It should make us, as Mary does, sing. Mary is slowly coming to understand. That's what she does. when she grasps it, she glorifies the Lord. She articulates the kindness that is shown to her personal, and she anticipates the kindness that is being offered to each and every one of us. A couple of weeks ago in the States, I think 2 weeks before that in Canada, they were celebrating Thanksgiving, weren't they? Shouldn't we as Christians be more thankful, more grateful than anyone else? And when we come to Christmas time and this glorious truth that the eternal Son, the eternal Word, took on flesh and made his dwelling amongst us, that the light came to shine in our darkness, shouldn't we be more grateful and thankful than any other? Favour should make us sing. Favour should fill us with gratitude. Favour should actually make us want to share what it is that we have. Not to say, no, I've got it, you don't, but this is what God gives. And it's free and it's undeserved and it's for you. And to reach out and to offer it to all people around us. Brothers and sisters, it is good news. It is God's grace. It is favour that the Son has come, that Jesus Christ was incarnate into our fallen, miserable, broken world, that he became a curse for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God, that he became a criminal hung on a cross so that we could be princes and princesses feasting at the king's table. You didn't earn that. We weren't even born when that happened. And it's not simply an idea on a page in a book or a thought and a reasoned argument that we can make in discussion with one another, but it's something that's for each and every one of us. And boy, oh boy, if we've got that, then we will be grateful people. So let's pray. Let's pray together and let's ask this great God of favour to make us grateful, to help us know and experience that grace in our lives day to day. And let's pray as well for others who are perhaps fighting, working, striving to earn that favourite status, that they would understand the contronym of God's favour. But that might be how it works with us in lots of different circumstances, but with him, it's entirely undeserved. Lord God, we thank you for your favour. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for this child who came, who grew, who lived, who died, who has risen to life again and is coming back. Lord God, you are a God who conceives and enacts and offers to us such wonderful salvation. How can we be puffed up when we receive that? Lord God, make us this Christmas as we contemplate it in different ways with songs and decorations and services and special Bible readings, whatever it is that we do, to focus our eyes and our minds and our hearts. Make us to be grateful people. Make us to be people who share and announce this favour that can be found. And Lord, I do pray for us as a church that the goodness that you have shown us, that your grace wouldn't just be a notion in our sermons, wouldn't just be trite answers in our Bible studies, but it would be the air that we breathe. That it would be the bread, the food which sustains us, Christ come into our world to rescue, to redeem, and to restore us. Lord, that would be something which is so near to us that it affects us every single day. Lord, we do not just pray for ourselves, but we pray for those that you have placed around us, that as we sing, as gratefulness wells up, Lord God, we wouldn't be given that impression that this is something that we have earned, something that we have achieved, a status that we have gotten for ourselves. But we, and deserving as everyone else, have simply found the favour of God. Lord, I pray that others would come to see that, recognise it, and respond to that this Christmas too. In Jesus' great and glorious name. Amen. Our great God of power, our great God of mercy, to you we turn, to you we trust, to you we bring our hopes, our fears, our prayers. Lord, give us hearts that are wide, give us hearts that are receptive and open to you, our great God, to you, Son, and your Holy Spirit. Remove from us all those things, those objects, those obsessions that hinder us from receiving Christ each day. Grow in us the peace and the joy promised to those who are found in him and with him. For Christ lives. Christ rules and reigns. Christ cares for all those he has rescued. So open our hearts, soften our exteriors, clear our way, fill us with your presence, make us your people, overflowing with grace. Amen.
Well, we're getting towards the end of our service together, so just let me give you a couple of notices before we close. The first is to remember Darganfod y Nadolig. That's our Welsh language carol service with the Town Silver Band, some various different other musical numbers too, and a really warm invitation to anybody to come along. Even if you're an English speaker, don't speak a word of Welsh, we'll have translation there as well, and the music will be something to enjoy. So come along. That's in Llandybie Memorial Hall. That's next Sunday evening at 6 o'clock. 22nd of December. And then there's Christmas Eve things coming up as well. Two things on Christmas Eve, family carols at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, Llandybie Memorial Hall. And then the late night, watch night carol service at 11 o'clock down in our church in Ammanford. And then Christmas morning, 10 a.m. Now there's lots of times to remember, but I hope you can find those on the website. Go to ammanfordchurch.com/Christmas, or just click on the Christmas button. You'll find a list of everything there. There's lots of paper invitations around church as well for you to pick up and invite people to. But pray for those. Come along, bring a friend, and they'll be a really good opportunity to take us into the Christmas season. But as we go, let's look back at some of Mary's words again and have these ringing in our ears as we go. Mary sang, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour, for he's been mindful of the humble state of his servant." He pays attention even to people like us. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He's brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. So let's pray as we go. Lord Jesus, we ask that you would help us. Help us to be like Mary. Lord, to welcome your grace that's been so generously given to us in your Son, the Lord Jesus. That, Lord, who are we that we would know favour from you? Humble people like us. Lord, would you lift us up? Would you keep us from being proud? Would you forgive us for our pride? Would you come to us, serve us, Lord, save us and help us this week as we walk with you. Amen. Amen.